Hi everyone, this is Dr. A. Narendra, MD Pediatrician from Hyderabad. In this session, we will discuss about post-COVID symptoms, especially fatigue. We have seen, India has seen a huge cases of COVID in second wave of COVID pandemic. Active cases have been calmed down, but what we are seeing is many complaints of fatigue, body pains, malaise, body aches, joint pains. These symptoms doesn't actually requires hospital admission, but these require a proper medical advice for getting completely relieved. So in this regard, we are advising patients, especially good food, balanced diet, next coming to proper sleep, and with the help of physiotherapists, the patients, we are advising patients to overcome these problems. In this regard, we have brought Dr. Anjali, physiotherapist. Ma'am is advocacy of at the global level of post-COVID symptoms. So, ma'am, are you live? Hello, ma'am. Are you live?
Backstage now.
Ma'am, are you live? Do you hear me, ma'am?
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay.
Can you get me backstage?
Okay, wait a minute.
Yeah. Hi.
Ma'am, hi, ma'am. I have introduced you as you, ma'am, on the my channel. Now we will go ahead, ma'am. Once again, who I missed, ma'am, is Dr. Anjali Agarwal. She's on a global level. She's advocacy of physiotherapist at India level. Welcome, ma'am, to this session. Today we will discuss about especially post-COVID long-term problems like body pains, malaise, and post-COVID lung rehabilitation. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. How are you, Dr. Narendra?
Thank you, ma'am. I'm good. Ma'am, we will start session now, right? Tell me, ma'am, what is especially lung rehabilitation? How parents and patients required this lung rehabilitation.
As we know, Dr. Narendra, that COVID is affecting a part of our lung and also our blood vessels, which is in our arteries and our heart. So
Yeah.
overall, when our lungs are affected, our capacity to breathe, exercise, and also to do, basic movements of the house, basic activities of the house gets very strenuous for us. So
Yes.
in cases of pulmonary rehab, I introduce something called as the 8-week program, where a post-COVID patient can enroll in this program. And it consists of a series of rehab with terms of exercising, pacing, management of
Okay.
shortness of breath, management of any kind of vertigo symptoms, management of your nutrition needs, and management of getting back to leading an active lifestyle without losing your breath. So most of the patients which I have been seeing post-COVID, they tend to get out of breath, even if they have to go to the washroom or if they're going to the kitchen to make a cup of tea also. So we need post-COVID patients to get back to leading a normal life, but in a very slow-paced manner. So this pulmonary rehab, we have taken it out from the same scenarios which we use for our COPD asthma patients, where we help the lung volume and the lung capacity to get better. So there's a series of exercises which one has to do, and they have to do it under the supervision of a physiotherapist. And I am doing it online now. You don't need to come meet me. We
Okay, some connection issues. Okay, what ma'am is especially focusing is that in post-COVID fatigue, to overcome fatigue, we have to pace ourselves, and immediately we cannot start jogging. Ma'am, are you back? Hello, ma'am, are you back?
Yeah, Dr. Narendra.
Yeah,
So I
doctor,
was,
right.
yeah. So I was at how do we increase our lung capacity depends on each individual person. So somebody wants to return back to jogging and running, I will not advise that post-COVID, at least for 3 months. So as a physio, we try to get and gauge their breathlessness score. We do a 6-minute walk test and see how much distance they can walk without their oxygen stats falling and without their pulse rate going very high. On those bases and those scenarios, we capture the data and we devise a pulmonary rehab for a post-COVID patient. And nowadays, what I see is most post-COVID patients have a lot of body pains. They're having a lot of muscle fatigue also. So obviously, we have to understand that as the lung is not functioning well, our muscles will not get the oxygen, which is derived from the blood also, from the hemoglobin also. We have to work in sync between the lung and the muscle together. So do not get your body so tired that you spend all the energy in a day. So what I use the word is called pace yourself. So my goal is to make a cup of tea without going breathless. So that is the goal I'll achieve day one. Day two, I will want to go and do the shopping, maybe out of the door and get my shopping bag inside. So all that requires a lot of effort. So a lot of post-COVID patients are saying a lot of body pains, which we see that if they've got steroid, it is affecting the bone health of most of the patients. And we know that steroid causes a lot of osteoporotic bones, and
Bone
that
density
can
will
also lead
increase.
into minor stress fractures. So one needs to be very careful of not going back and start doing gym activities and running without a supervision of a physiotherapist.
We have to actually schedule, as ma'am said, on day one, we have to just we keep our goals very small. As the days progress, we can pace our activities. Ma'am, because of this post-COVID shortness of breath, many patients are restricted to bed and or a chair. So how this posture and especially in sitting and while on bed is important, ma'am? Can you explain our audience better?
Yeah. So when we know that our lungs are not working well, we always tend to tell them to have 2 to 3 pillows at the back, have a propped up position of the lung at a 45 degree semi-reclined position. So most of the patients, I'm telling you, they are recovering out of post-COVID and having issues with breathlessness. If they're having sleep apnea, most of my patients are complaining about getting up in the night and panting for air or breath. And it's mostly I'm seeing is there's something called as a breathing dysfunction or sleep apnea-like setting which is happening. So prop your pillow up and don't have a lot of heavy meal in the night so that your stomach muscles are not working hard and pushing on the diaphragm. That's one thing. Second thing, when you're sitting in front of your television or your computer or work, try to get up as often as possible. When you do that, you will exercise the anti-gravity muscles, which are your quadriceps, which are your back muscles. And when these muscles are working, your efficiency of using oxygen will also improve. So I would say more movement, but at a pace level, and do not try to tire yourself over the day. Try to have a posture which is more upright rather than more, the sedentary or lying down on the bed flat. When you lie down flat on the bed, the diaphragm and it doesn't work well. So either have a semi-reclined position or go into a stoop position little bit if you are feeling breathless. If you're working without breathlessness, always have an upright posture. You're using your mobile phone, have a posture where your neck is not too stooped down. So these are things which can help you to take care of your bone health also and your posture. Yeah.
Ma'am, can you explain what are the ways to work on lung health, especially lung rehabilitation post-COVID?
Yeah. So I would say start slow, but go with the flow. So start slow means I will measure my pulse ox, I'll measure my pulse rate, and I also measure my BP, blood pressure, pre and post exercise. By knowing that, I know what is the level at which I can exercise, or we say called my heart rate, perceived heart rate, or perceived exertional rate. So I would say try to take a walk from your bedroom to and see how your pulse oxygen is doing day one, day two, day three. That's one thing. Second thing, you can do a count shell breathing. In our Indian circumstances, all our temples or yeah, so you can do a conch shell breathing. You can do incentive spirometry, which is the three balls, and you can increase your lung capacity. You can do deep breathing exercise, which is divided into apical, basal breathing, and diaphragmatic breathing. I always tell people to divide it over the day so that your lung is all the time getting the oxygen and the chance of fibrosis decreases post-COVID. And also work on your muscle building exercise, which is little bit of small dumbbells or weights you can use to build the muscles of your biceps and quads. Because the more the muscle builds, your capacity to use up oxygen will improve. And the same concept which we use for COPD management and pulmonary rehab for COPD, the same thing we call for lung health. Now, I called for two things, which is called mucus clearance techniques, which is called the ACVT technique, which is called active clearance technique. So now the weather is like very humid and it's raining. People tend to accumulate a lot of mucus in their airways. So keep your airways clean and make sure that you're always having little sips of warm water, which will help to clear up the mucus and will not let this mucus thicken and will not let to trap viruses, fungi, molds in this humid weather. So the key thing is to keep the mucus always mobile. So you can do like, this is called as the huffing cuffing technique, which we as physiotherapists have always used for most of our chest patients, like people who require chest physiotherapy. Use it on a daily basis so that your mucus is not remaining in the alveolus. And don't use very forced breath because that will close your alveolus. Use very slow, deep breath so that your alveolus remains functional and remains open. That's how you can take care of your lung health. And don't eat food which can cause, avoid sugary food, avoid fizzy drinks, maintain exercises which will help to mobilize your mucus. Thank you.
Very beautiful advice, ma'am, to loosen the mucus which is get trapped in the alveoli, especially hydration part and cough technique. Definitely my audience will follow these advice. How this pulmonary rehabilitation differs from other rehabilitation programs, ma'am?
Yeah, so pulmonary rehab focuses a lot on the lung health, and it
Okay.
also focuses on the overall health of an individual. So other rehabs, like if we go for a knee replacement or a hip replacement, we tend to rehab the knee joint. We tend to tell the person to mobilize out of bed and let them learn how to walk, learn to climb steps and all. But in pulmonary rehab, we tend to tell the person how to breathe well. And once they breathe well, their oxygenation will improve, their cardiac health will improve. As a result of that, their muscle health and the overall general well-being will also improve. The person's level of anxiety, depression will come down, breathlessness will come down, his ability to eat food and also use of that energy which he gets from the food will also improve. So this is the importance of pulmonary rehab. So it will get you back your lung, which was there prior to COVID.
Now the post-COVID patients required a structured pulmonary rehab program to get most benefit of it. So it is always advisable to get services from a certified physiotherapist like you, ma'am. And definitely, our audience will try to approach ma'am. And after the session, I will share your contact to our audience. Okay, ma'am. Thank you for our session. Okay, ma'am, any things you want to share with the audience now?
Dr. Narendra, there's a lot of question about this COVID. Yeah, doctor, I'm there. Yeah, so Dr. Narendra, I see a lot of COVID wave which is being talked about among the children. What are your views and thoughts about vaccination for kids?
Now we have seen first wave and second wave. Now the cases of the second wave have been decreased, and now most of the adults above 45 and above 18 plus are getting vaccinated. Now currently we are having three vaccines: Covishield, Covaxin, and Sputnik. And the children vaccination for COVID is under trials, and even in India trials have been began. We have to wait until the trials have been published. Once the trials have shown that it is safe to give in children, then we will be ready for vaccination even in children. Apart from COVID, our children, wait a minute. Ma'am, do you hear me? Apart from COVID,
Yeah,
do you
Dr.
think
Narendra.
apart from COVID vaccination, our children require regular vaccines also? Because of fear of COVID, many parents are not bringing their child to vaccination centers for even for regular vaccinations. This is going to have a bad impact on their health, because there are many proved vaccines, example measles vaccine, pneumococcal vaccine, influenza vaccine, MMR vaccine. These vaccines are proved and they are going to prevent the diseases which they are intended for. Because of these vaccinations, our immunity will be constantly
So, what is
getting.
your advice for the parents? What's your advice for children to prevent and also to fight COVID? If they get it, what is the way you would advise they should do? What should parents be doing? I see you being a pediatrician, you're doing such fabulous job COVID related. Okay.
Ma'am,
So what's your advice to the parents?
my advice to parents in this post-COVID and ahead of the third wave of COVID pandemic,
Yeah.
early diagnosis and treatment is going to help, ma'am. Because once the child get fever, we don't know exactly whether it is a viral infection or a bacterial infection. Even it is a viral infection, whether it is a COVID virus or it is a dengue virus. So what I suggest parents is that they have to meticulously see their child at this pandemic times, and they have to note a few things. Especially, they have to note the day of onset of symptoms, that is fever or a sore throat or ear pain, rashes on the skin, or is there any pain during passing urine, or is there any change in the pattern of stools, especially is there any diarrhea, and there is any headache and level of activity or a seizure activity, or there is any skin rash. So all these things are going to be important. Apart from symptoms, we have to see what is the level of activity of the child, whether the child is active or dull. Coming to next thing, how many times the baby or child is passing urine, and this is going to tell especially about the hydration status of the child. Next, coming to after level of activity and feeding, we have to see urine output, and see, and we have to consult doctor as early as possible, because and we have to be clear whether it is bacterial infections like sore throat or ear infection or urinary tract infections, in which antibiotics are going to help, or we have to see whether it is COVID virus or it is or due to other virus like dengue infections.
Dr. Narendra. So thank you, Dr. Narendra. That was such a insightful answer for parents. I think they're very much worried. And most of my patients who are in the pandemic time, children are not going out of the house. What are your advice for the small children? Should they be wearing the mask as we fear that the third wave will hit the kids? What should they do?
We do not advise mask in less than 2 years children. In about 2 to 5 years, we prefer them using a fabric mask. Especially when now there are no schools and most of the academic activities are going to online. The concentration levels have been decreased when compared to offline schools, and most of the times the attention span has been decreased. I always advise to have a grandparent or a parent or a caretaker to along with the child attend the sessions, because on the phone the attention span of the child is very less. When there is supportive supervision, definitely is going to help their kids academically. And next, after sessions, give a break, like just after 30-minute session, give a break for 5 minutes, and in that we can have a cup of water, or they can have a short walk, or in the evenings on the terrace they can have, after drawing the circles around 6 feet distance on the terrace, they can have a circles drawn, and in these circles they can have a small jumping sessions or jogging sessions like that, to have a little bit physical activity, because we are not allowing children to go out of our apartments or flats. So have a little physical activity and supervision, and there are many good indoor games which can be help apart from digital games. Now indoor games like carom or chess or a new storytelling is going to help to increase both vocabulary and intelligence of the child. So I think the parents has to think what best alternatives so that I engage my child apart from smartphones or tabs giving to their children.
True.
They have to think more alternatives like storytelling or singing or dancing like that.
So yeah, Dr. Narendra. Yeah. So with regards to the kind of nutrition the child needs, so that his immunity is good. What is your advice? Like, what should the child eat or drink? What should the parents focus on when they are trying to make sure the child's immunity is good?
Coming to a nutritious part, it's a balanced home prepared balanced diet. I advise all my parents to have a home prepared balanced diet. First basic thing they have to do is that have anthropometry of their child, especially what is the weight of my baby, what is the height of my baby. So after getting anthropometry, we can I advise always anthropometry of the child, like height and weight of the child, because these height and weight will tell whether their child is appropriate according to their age. If they are appropriate according to age and their parents are actually doing good about nutrition, if the child is overweight or the child is underweight, then we have to provide more calories and more proteins to add to their balanced diet. I always recommend protein good at these children muscle mass bones are growing, so I always recommend them to provide proteins both from animal sources and from plant sources if they are from a veg community. As for animal proteins, there are good proteins can be seen from a boiled egg or a lean chicken. They can have it. For veg counterparts, they have very good amount of pulses like soya beans, lentils, red gram, and Bengal gram. Coming to calcium, calcium is very important for their bones. It can be provided through dairy products like milk, curd, cheese, yogurt. So I always advise my parents to see what protein they are providing in their regular diet, be it be animal protein or a plant protein. And dairy products daily, they must include dairy products in their diet. Coming to they have to all children must be provided fresh fruits, because these fresh fruits contains a lot of vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. Fruits can be anything. It can be a seasonal fruit. So what are available in the market, but it should be fresh. Like it can be mango, it can be guava, it can be apple, strawberry, pineapple, anything. But they have to provide one fruit salad in the evening in their diet plan. So my advice is that proteins, number one, number two, calcium, dairy products, number three, fruits for vitamins and minerals, apart from their regular diet.
And Dr. Narendra, there's the funniest thing which I keep hearing from my patients who are postpartum moms and they have small children about 2 or 3 years old. They are also making something called as immunity booster and they're asking the child to drink it. You know, it could be having a lot of turmeric and, methi water. And I keep telling that the child may not need so many of these immunity boosters because any which ways you're putting your turmeric in the curry, right? When you make your vegetables or your dal, you're putting the turmeric in. But people are adamantly making the child drink this immunity booster.
Actually, truly speaking, there is no food like which boosts our immunity. The only thing which boosts our immunity is vaccines. Vaccines going to boost our immunity because they will train our immune system to fight the natural viruses and bacteria. And vaccines are only immunity boosters, and these all foodstuffs are going only myths. Actually, wholesome nutritious food will helps our immunity to building up, but not an individual food like, as you said, turmeric or like that. If we use such things, many children will suffer from gastritis. And I have seen some bringing their children with vomitings or like that. Better, we should not advise, especially below 5 years, we should not force the children to drink such type of preparations, because it's going to impact their overall eating habits. When a mother is trying to force children to feed that ingredient, even the child earlier foods like even like curd, she may not prefer because mother is trying to feed mother is trying to force the child. Even so, in such conditions, the child may even not the foods which she ate previously. So better avoid such things.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Narendra. That's so insightful and so helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, Dr.
Thank you for the session. Bye.